ASCO panel noted that certain uncommon breast cancer types, tubular bacillus, have a favorable prognosis, and this histological information could be relevant. So it is not the only factor that we take into consideration. However, larger data sets are not currently available to confirm how best to treat patients with tubular and mucinous carcinoma. Next. Lymphovascular invasion predicted worse outcome in some studies. This entire thing has been taken from an update of the ASCO endorsement of the Cancer Ontario guidelines. So it is not something that it's available on the net. So LVI, the St. Gallen consensus conference, felt that it is not sufficient to decide. Sometimes I have seen medical oncologists saying that there is LVI and we need to give chemotherapy. But the St. Gallen consensus conference is wonders about its reproducibility. In the absence of other comorbidities, advanced age should not be used as an independent criterion to not recommend chemotherapy. Sometimes I feel that we are under-treating elderly patients, or sometimes we may be even over-treating them. So that balance is very important at elderly ages. Younger age can be more often related with aggressive tumor biology or subtypes, and can also predict response to certain treatment. Again, in younger patients, there is a problem because we want to spare fertility in younger patient, and to avoid certain adverse effect in older patient might affect selection of treatment. Can you go back to the last slide? The ASCO panel recommends measurement of estimated life expectancy and validated geriatric assessment tool for making decision for elderly patients. Next. Therefore, we have gone from a traditional TNM tumor node mets grade Ki-67 dependent IHC4 luminal classification and the various online tools to the most recent multi-gene assays. Why do we want to reduce over-treatment of breast cancer with precision medicine? Because it brings down the cost of treatment, and it's a tailor-made treatment. Those patients who require chemotherapy, they are at high risk, and those who are not go into hormonal treatment. Logistically, it makes more sense. Toxicity can be avoided, and the long-term side effects of chemotherapy also can be avoided. Next. So there is some background noise. Can I request all the attendees to just mute their audio? What happens is that most of the data or the tools that we have now, the multi-gene assays, they have been designed in Western population without including an Asian cohort. So these are some publications from Science Direct, whether it was Adjuvant Online and various other models predict, were not very effective. They significantly overestimated survival in patients less than 40, and they were not suitable in Asian patients. Next. So, as you all know that many of the multi-gene assays have already been included in all the guidelines, whether it is ASCO, AJCC, NCCN, ESMO, and the NICE. And therefore, we were always looking at a multi-gene assay that would be effective for Indian patients, where a large number of Indian patients had participated in the validation study. And based on those genes, we could probably devise a multi-gene assay that would predict outcomes in Indian patients. Next. What happens is that the currently available multi-gene assays have been designed for a Western world. They have been essentially validated in postmenopausal women. Younger age groups are less represented. Asian ethnicities are poorly represented in validation. There is a significantly higher cost and turnaround time, because most of the time the samples have to be sent to either to the US or to Europe. Next. There is a slight lag because Sukruti is managing the slides, and because she is the host and will also admit people. So I think Sukruti, you will agree with me that the number of node positive patients is also quite high in the validation study that you have done. And that is also something that I was pleasantly surprised to know. So this is a prognostic test, Mama Print, for example, when compared to in Japan and Korea, it gave nearly 80% of patients at high risk. And unlike in Western countries, Netherlands and European countries, where only 60% of the patients were high risk, in Japan and Korea, the number of high risk patients came out to be 80 and 86%. And therefore, they felt that there is some genetic disparity between Caucasians and Asians, by which some of these multi-gene assays are not likely to be very effective in these patients. Next. So this is the Asian Breast Cancer Cooperative Group 2019, where they said that Asian women have distinctive clinopathological characteristics, and extrapolating all data from Western patients to non-Asian postmenopausal women may have its own problems. So premenopausal Asian women with breast cancer have a unique, may I come to the conclusion, and they will benefit from treatment that is different from international guidelines. And we need to design our own guidelines with cooperative groups like the Asian Breast Cancer Cooperative Group. Next. So within India, the ICMR guidelines also do not include the Western tests because there is inadequate validation on Indian patients. So the multi-gene Mama Print Oncotype DX, they are still not part of the ICMR guidelines because they feel that they have not been adequately or not at all validated in the Indian population. Next. Indian patients are likely to be younger. We all know that Dr. Benival and Dr. Gupta have a long-standing experience. So the median age is around 48, higher tumor burden, primarily node positive, symptomatic stage 2 disease. There, the patients are elderly, the median age around 60, smaller tumors, screen detected, primarily stage 0 DCIS and stage 1 disease. So there was always an unmet need to have a test developed on Indian patients. Next. So we need make in India, India specific solutions for this particular situation. Next. As you all know, the incidence of breast cancer in India is extremely high. Currently, we see around 160,000 new cases of breast cancer every year. And the mortality is extremely high even now with all the efforts that we as oncologists do. It could be as high as about 50%, and nearly half the patients diagnosed of breast cancer every year die in our country, which is a really, an eye-opener for us. This afternoon, I was talking to a group of medical postgraduate students across a couple of medical colleges. And there I emphasize, because at one time, at one level, we need to emphasize very simple things like, mammography, core biopsy, basic mastectomy, adjuvant chemotherapy. And in tertiary referral centers, you will also come across patients with very small tumor, node negative, and who can probably afford this sort of multi-gene assay. So India is a very heterogeneous mix of patient populations, and we have to really cater to all the entire populace. Next. So this is basically the same thing in a different slide, and breast cancer is probably the highest cancer prevalence amongst women in India. Next. We all know the benefits of early detection. Survival is, if not 100%, very, very high, in excess of 90-95%. We can avoid very aggressive treatment in many patients. Breast conservation is always possible. And that option that women are always been looking for is whether they can avoid chemotherapy. Next. These are some slides which show that there is some Indian data that is coming out in different contexts. This was in context with breast conservation surgery. So Indian surgeons, Indian breast oncologists have been able to adapt to the changing scenario across, and we have taken to breast conserving surgery in a big way. Next. A lot of centers across India now do breast conserving surgery for early breast cancer. Similarly, sentinel lymph node biopsy rates, though, are low, but we are constantly innovating to overcome lack of resources. So we have people like Dr. Somshekhar, who first did a lot of work with sentinel node with the radioactive dye, and now is into the fluorescent dye. And therefore, the cost of the entire procedure will come down, and it will be more available for node negative patients, whereas many centers will be able to do a sentinel lymph node biopsy. Next. This was an article by Kiran Majmudar Shaw, in which he said that leveraging affordable innovation to tackle India's healthcare challenge. So we have to be constantly innovative to find solutions, because it's a huge challenge out there. Next. Therefore, this company, OncoStem Diagnostics, and we are happy to have the founder of the company, Manjari Bakre, we'll meet her at the end of the lecture. And she and a group of scientists in Bangalore, and again, that was where I was born, and this brilliant idea was also born there, can assist breast. So they came up with this multi-gene assay, which has five IHC biomarkers and three clinical parameters. Some of the multi-gene assays have not included clinical parameters into their model. So, but this has been able to take five biomarkers and three clinical markers, and with the help of machine learning and algorithm, create a can assist breast risk score where the cutoff is 15.5. Anything less than 15.5 or less is low risk. 15.5 and above is obviously high risk. And it was done using a training set of 298 patient samples. Next. So what this does is, if I may just, so there are a couple of genes here, ABCC4, ABCC11, N-cadherin, etc. And they work at different levels. So these genes were first identified. What does CD44 do? It is works here at the epithelial mesenchymal transition. N-cadherin, pan-cadherin are extravasation and mesenchymal epithelial MET gene. And for chemotherapy resistance, these genes are responsible, ABCC4 and ABCC11. So between them, they control many very important facts of tumor progression for self-renewal, loss of self-adhesion, migration, invasion, drug resistance, and some of these things could eventually lead to metastasis. So these genes were identified, and then mutations in those genes were to be checked for. Next. So over a period of 9 years, it has gone from analytical validity to clinical validity to, and it's commercially available now. And currently, I think it has been used in more than 900 patients for prognosticating the risk of recurrence. Next. Validation tests have also been conducted, obviously, across India, USA, and Europe. And these are some of the hospitals which initially gave a lot of blocks and slides in order to develop the model, the validation model. Next. How has can assist worked in the on the bedside? So it is an Indian cohort where, if you see, for patients less than 50 years, if the can assist score is low risk, which was 74% population, 26 were high risk, there is a significant difference in the disease free distant metastasis free survival. So this graph clearly demonstrates a wide gap, and therefore it is very useful in patients, especially because in India, many of the patients are less than 50 years of age. For patients greater than 50 years of age, the gap may be small, but there is a distinct gap between the patients who had a can assist low risk versus a can assist high risk score. And this was for a period of almost 80 months. And therefore, it is risk stratification is similar in patients across age groups. Next. This is similarly for the total cohort of all patients, 95 versus 85. And that was statistically significant, where low risk patients do much better and then compared to patients who had a high risk. And those patients who received endocrine therapy alone, again, 95% distant metastasis DMFS versus 83% for patients who had a high-risk CAB score. CAN-ASIS breast stratification has a negative predictive value of 95% and risk stratification is unaffected by chemotherapy. Next. If you see a group of patients who are low risk, so whether you gave them chemoendocrine therapy or only endocrine therapy, there is an overlap of the two graphs and 96% of patients were alive at the end of 80 months. So distant metastasis-free survival was 96% at the end of 80 months. So it didn't matter. So you could have probably avoided giving chemotherapy in some of these patients. But for those who are high risk, the graph clearly shows a fall off at the end of 80 months because those who received chemoendocrine obviously did better because they were in a high risk group than patients who were in a low risk group because they received only endocrine therapy. If they received only endocrine therapy, then they seem to do much worse. That's what this slide tries to say. Next. Now, amongst patients treated with endocrine therapy alone, the total cohort is about 741 patients. Those who are low risk did well. Those high risk, you give them only endocrine therapy, then they don't seem to do so well. T1 node negative, T1, T2 node negative. Again, that basically it is the same thing. So it identifies the within a clinically low risk group, you know, basically T1 node negative, T2 node negative. Clinically, at the reflexly, we think that they are in low-risk group. But amongst them, some patients are likely to fail. So what this test does is it helps in identifying the high-risk patients amongst this population of low-risk group. Next. Comparison. So now, anyone would want next. So that we validated it against the currently, we seem to think that the Western test is the gold standard. So whether it is Oncotype DX or Mama Print, or there are a whole plethora of tests available now. So the company has gone ahead and validated this test against Oncotype DX, which is the oldest test available in the market. And it seemed to do very well. CAN-ASIS and Oncotype DX have an 83% concordance in the low risk stratification. So whether you used the Oncotype DX with the old cutoff or after the Taylor X cutoff, they changed the goal settings. And therefore, whether it was with the old or the new, it showed an excellent concordance. Next. So I think this is basically the same slide where whether you do CAN-ASIS, Oncotype DX or the Oncotype DX after Taylor X, the number of patients who did well with endocrine therapy, they seem to be the same. So good concordance between these two tests. Next. We have always used Ki-67 as a marker of proliferation marker and less than 14. So we always felt that patients who had a higher Ki-67 are at higher risk. But what CAN-ASIS breast has done is it has even stratified among patients with Ki-67 into two categories. And therefore, a higher number of patients, even patients with a higher Ki-67 can still be stratified as low risk because of this test called CAN-ASIS breast. Next. I think basically the same slide which says that 21% of low Ki-67 were stratified as high risk, thus preventing undertreatment, and 75% of high Ki-67 were stratified as low risk, thus preventing overtreatment. Next. Again, because Ki-67 is part of the luminal subtypes, it is an overlap of probably what has already been done, and 31% of the cohort are luminal A, 75% are low risk by CAN-ASIS breast. So within that subgroup also, there could be some patients who are at high risk who would probably need chemotherapy and some in whom we could avoid chemotherapy. So 19% of luminal A stratified as high risk by Canisius breast with an NPV of 98%, and 72% of luminal B stratified as low risk by Canisius breast with an NP of 94. Next. So if endocrine therapy alone was used sub-cohort, depending upon luminal A and luminal B, the distant metastasis free survival was 97 versus 92%, and but for here it fell off between 95 to 86%. Canisius low versus high. Next. As you can see, it has been extensively used. I am one of the size of the dot probably corresponds to the number of times it has been used, and probably within Gujarat we are one of the highest users of the Canisius breast, and for over 900 to 1000 patients. The end result, the result is the 67% have been classified as low risk, 33% have been classified as high risk. It includes node negative, node positive patients and T1, T2 cases. Generally, grade 1, 17%, grade 2, 65, and some grade 3 tumors also. And majority of the patients are above the age of 50, though about 30% of patients could be less than 50 years of age. And they have even gone back to check whether there is adherence to the guideline, and nearly 64% of patients therefore avoided chemotherapy. Next. So therefore, Canisius breast is a robust, cost-effective IHC-based prognostic test, and therefore it brings down the cost and can be standardized very specifically, independent of cohort-specific differences, age and node status. Chemotherapy benefit is observed only in high-risk patients. Greater than 83% concordance between CAB low-risk and Oncotype DX low-risk categories. Can be stratified patients more accurately than Ki-67 luminal AB IHC-based risk stratification. Prevents under-treatment or over-treatment of patients. Early data shows that CAB has saved 64% of patients from chemotherapy in a prospective manner in India till date. Next. In keeping with the Prime Minister's idea of Make in India, this is a good test that has been developed, a very good, in fact, that has been developed at Bangalore by OncoStem, and they are trying to get it into the international guidelines also after a trial or a study is conducted in some of the Western countries. Next. One slide before I conclude is, it is only indicated, genomic testing only indicated in patients with hormone receptor positive, HER2 negative, and those up to 3 nodes. Genomic testing generally not done for patients with hormone receptor negative, more than 3 nodes, HER2 positivity or TNBC outside the context of a clinical trial. Should generally be not performed in patients in whom the results, this is very important, that if you feel that the patient is unlikely to receive chemotherapy even otherwise, then you might not as well do the test at all. So go ahead and give her hormone therapy. So neither ASCO nor NCCN guidelines currently imply the superiority of one genomic test over another. And because they have been validated across different patient populations, there could be some discordance between test A versus test.